Can you see the great cloud of witnesses? You remember last week, we talked about them, all of them, all the great cloud of witnesses. Can you feel their presence? They've all set up a tent on Grand Boulevard, and they are cheering us on as we run this marathon, this race of perseverance. They're all there, Noah and his wife, and Abraham and Sarah, and Isaac and Rebekah, and Jacob and Rachel. And of course, I can see Moses and Miriam and Joshua, and even Rahab is there. There are prophets and kings and martyrs, and they're all here to cheer us on. You see, we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, and they're here to cheer us on when we succeed, but they are also here to encourage us and cheer us on even when we fail, even when we fall. I'd like to invite you to open your bulletin. You'll see your sermon notes printed out for you, and they'll help you to follow along with our scripture today. And there's a place to write down anything you'd like to remember and take with you. And if you open that on up, you'll see our prayer and study guide. And these are daily scriptures and devotions you can take with you into the week. We have been reading through all 13 chapters of the letter to the Hebrews. And so let us persevere and finish it out and read chapter 12 and chapter 13 this week. But I want to ask you a question. What do you do when you fail? Do you quit or do you pick yourself up and try again? I have been thinking about some of my own athletic achievements. 31 years ago in 1988, I was an eighth grader at Hefner Junior High, and I was on the track team. And our first track meet that year was at Carl Albert High School. And I felt pretty good about my chances. And so it was the first 110-meter hurdles race of the first track meet of the year. And so I think I even told them I was faster than I actually was to make sure that I got in the first heat of the preliminary races. I was just sure that I would win a medal that day if I ran my race. And I was in lane six, the outside lane, and I actually brought you a little footage. It's got a little patina on it because it's 31 years old. But before we had cell phones, VHS tapes, and they weren't always the clearest. But I'm the one at the bottom in lane six. So take a look at my first race in seventh grade. It still hurts today, and that second time hurts worse than the first. But therefore, since we're surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and our favorite sins that cling so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. Sometimes you fall. Sometimes you fall twice in one race. But when you fall, it's important to get up and finish the race. That's what I did that day. I remember my knees and elbows were skinned. There were black tar marks on my uniform and those really fancy short shorts I was wearing that day. But I was going to win a medal. But then I fell. And then I fell again. And sometimes you fall. Sometimes you fail. And you may not want to hear that, but I'm telling you, and most of you know it, sometimes you fail. And we fail even in our Christian journey, in our Christian race. And when you fall, are you going to lay there on the track or are you going to get up and finish the race? Let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. You know, I find in life that sometimes the way you win is simply to not quit. I didn't quit the track team that day. I still had another race and there were other medals to be won. And that same day, I actually did win a medal, third place in the 200-meter hurdles. This was my first medal that I won in seventh grade, and I was, you know, kind of took a little bit of the sting away from that day. But it was not the only time I fell. Actually, 2 years later in ninth grade, Carl Albert High School again, lane six again, this time the 300-meter hurdles. And over the I was going around the curve, and the last hurdle that was staggered, my left foot hit in the lane inside of mine, and I fell again. This time I got up, and I finished. I even waved at the crowd as I was bringing up the end of that one. I hated the 300 hurdles. I never really liked that race. But I'll tell you, though, the 110-meter hurdles that day were a little more gracious to me, and they didn't always give fourth-place medals, but I got a fourth-place medal in the 110-meter hurdles that day at Carl Albert 2 years later. So, therefore, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely. Let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. That was his reward. His reward for enduring the cross. And through the most difficult parts of our Christian marathon, we look to Jesus for our hope and for our inspiration. And we remember that he suffered for us. He died for us so that we might live for him. You see, to run this race, to live this life, it requires everything that we have or we won't make it. We must lay aside every weight. Every one of our favorite little sins that we think we enjoy so much, push them aside so that we can give our all to following Jesus, to worshiping him, to serving him, to living and following in his footsteps, knowing that our perseverance will be rewarded. See, this race is a long race. It's a marathon. So what we do is we pick up our cross and we follow Jesus wherever he leads us. I mean, just think about Jesus' journey to the cross, mocked, flogged, hung on a cross to die. Consider him who endured such hostility against himself from sinners so that you may not grow weary or lose heart. You see, God has a way of redeeming our suffering, redeeming our greatest pains in life. You know, Jesus didn't want to die, but he was willing to die. He was willing to suffer. He was willing to die on the cross because he loved us. He died for us so that we might live for him. And on the third day, God redeemed his suffering and raised him from the grave. And through him, through his life, through his death, through his resurrection, he offers us grace, forgiveness, eternal life. And the pastor who wrote this letter, he reminds us, in your struggle against sin, you've not resisted to the point of shedding your blood. You haven't yet become a martyr, and hopefully it doesn't come to that. It could, but hopefully not. And you've forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as children. My child, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord or lose heart when you're punished by him, for the Lord disciplines those whom he loves and chastises every child whom he accepts. And so the pastor who wrote this letter, he says to the congregation, this suffering that you're going through right now, it's God's way of disciplining you. And I want to be clear, because we don't believe that God causes bad things to happen to us, and most certainly not all forms of suffering are God's attempts to discipline us. However, there are seasons in our life, seasons of being tested, where sometimes God works through a season of testing to shape us and to form us. And I find that even the suffering we go through that God doesn't cause, God finds a way to redeem. God finds a way even to help us grow stronger and to survive and to come out the other side when we do suffer. But the pastor quotes Proverbs 3, verses 11 to 12. That's what he's quoting here to remind the congregation that God is their father and we are his children. And good parents discipline their children actually because they love them and with the goal of teaching and forming to help them to grow and to mature. So God's discipline is not meant to cause us to lose heart and always seems painful when we're going through it, However, when God helps us grow through the difficult parts of our lives, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace. And so the pastor goes on to tell us, here's how you get through those times. Endure trials for the sake of discipline. God's treating you as children, for what child is there whom a parent does not discipline? If you do not have that discipline in which all children share, then you are illegitimate and not his children. Moreover, we had human parents to discipline us, and we respected them. Should we not be even more willing to be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as seemed best to them, but he disciplines us for our good in order that we may share his holiness. Now, discipline always seems painful rather than pleasant at the time, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. So as God disciplines us, we grow in discipline, and being disciplined by God, or even growing to have discipline ourselves, isn't always fun. I mean, when you're on a diet, it isn't fun to say no to that dessert, right? It's not fun necessarily to go and work out at the gym 4 times a week. It's not fun to run extra laps after practice after everyone else has gone home. But everyone admires the person who has discipline. Everyone is impressed to see the weight that you have lost. Everyone is impressed to see just how long you can run out on the soccer field because you have trained, because you have gone through and disciplined your body and disciplined yourself. We don't always enjoy being disciplined, but we love the results, the fruitful harvest of being disciplined. And this marathon, this pilgrimage, it rewards those who are disciplined, who persevere, who don't quit, who keep going, who keep walking step after step after step, day after day. Have you ever considered the impact a faithful, disciplined person can have over the course of a lifetime? I'm talking about the type of person who daily gets up, and they have character and they have discipline, and each day they just find really simple ways to bless other people. Maybe with a kind word of encouragement, maybe with a hug or a smile. Maybe it's through the ways that they serve and they help those who are in need. But I find that those people that just daily do that, they change the world. They change the course of the people's lives that they know because they care. And the marathon, it rewards those who are disciplined. I mean, consider the tortoise and the hare. You know this story. The hare always bragged about how fast he was, how great he was, until the tortoise got fed up with it and challenged him to a race. The gun went off. The tortoise took one plodding step and then another, and the hare said, "Man, this guy is slow," and he decided to take a nap. And when he woke up, he was only around the first curve, and so the hare had a big breakfast and fell asleep again. And when he finally woke up, there was the tortoise crossing the finish line. It was too late. Have you ever noticed that the tortoise wins the race every single time? Slow and steady wins the race. God is able to use a faithful person with discipline who perseveres to bless many people. Therefore, lift your drooping hands, strengthen your weak knees, and make straight paths for your feet, so that what is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. The pastor calls the congregation to pursue peace with everyone. As much as it depends on you, pursue peace with everyone and the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. Holiness, it means set apart. Of course, it means being pure and sinless too, but it means being set apart with a purpose. So live in peace, be set apart for God's purpose. See to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springs up and causes trouble, and through it many become defiled. Bitterness, you ever seen that? Bitterness, you're bitter, and it can rub off on people, it can cause problems. He says, no, don't let that take over the congregation. Let peace, let the spirit of building each other up, let that win the day. Because we're in this together. We run the race together. And if someone lags behind, if you notice that person that usually sits by you hadn't been sitting by you for some time, It's our job to go find them, to go find the lost sheep of Nichols Hills and to bring them in, to remind them how much we love them and care about them and how much God loves them and cares about them. And he warns of the damage that bitterness can cause. Now, once in a while, the pastor gets a little stern. Once in a while, he says, I want to warn you. If you turn this loose, you may not be able to pick it up again. Remember Esau. Esau, godless person, sold his birthright, sold his inheritance for one pot, for one bowl of stew. And afterwards, he wanted it back, but it was too late. Some things, you turn them loose, you don't take hold of them again. He sought it with repentance. He sought it with tears. But it was too late because the iron, once heated, once it cools, you can't heat it again. If you've tasted the good word of God and the heavenly gift and known the Holy Spirit and tossed them out, you can whistle and you can beckon and you can call and you can cry and repent and they don't come back. At least that's what this pastor says. It's tough. But I believe this pastor doesn't warn us to condemn us. He warns us because he cares. He warns us because he cares about the church and he cares about the people. And so he tells us, see to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God. I mean, if someone begins to slip away, whose job is it to go find them, bring them back? It's our job. It's your job. It's my job. It's our job to see to it that no one fails to obtain the grace of God. You see, it's our job to care about people, let them know we care about them, let them know that God cares about them. Oh, sometimes people think that others don't care. In a large church, we could kind of get lost, kind of be anonymous. One Sunday, a man who was a leader in his church, he had to leave, go to a district meeting, a rally of some sort, so he told his family goodbye, and he started out the back door, had to go through the choir room on the way to the parking lot. Choir members putting up their robes, and he passed by this woman that he knew quite well. She was putting up a robe. He said, I really enjoyed the anthem this morning. She said, well, I hope so, because that's it. Well, what do you mean that's it? I'm hanging it up. She was hanging up a robe. He said, you're hanging it up. She said, I'm hanging it up. And he said, well, what's the matter with you? And she said, this is my last Sunday. And, you know, he thought maybe she was retiring. She'd been in the choir about 103 years. Voice was starting to crack a little bit. And she said, no, I'm not retiring. I'm quitting. Well, why are you quitting? She said, well, I finally accepted the question that has haunted me for years. I sat up in the choir this morning. I just looked out at the people out there, looked at the pastor, looked at the music director, looked at the ushers out there doing their thing, and I just thought to myself, who cares? He said, who cares? She said, who cares? Who cares if I'm in the choir or not, or whether I'm here or not? He said, oh, you're just feeling bad. Go home, take an aspirin, and have a nice lunch. And he left, but he couldn't get her off his mind because he was a member of that church. And what she had done was indict them all. Because if they didn't care for her, no matter how beautiful their choir, no matter how mammoth their organ, how big their budget, if they didn't care for her, then they were not a church. And they could not assemble in the name of the one who did not break a bruised reed. And it worried him to death. Went to the district meeting, didn't have his mind on it, came home, called her. May I come over and talk to you? She said, if you want to. He said, well, I want to. And so he went over there and they talked and he said, you're wrong. And she said, I'm not wrong. And he said, do you know what you did? You said to me this morning that we are not a church. Well, he told her a little church history. What you said of our church used to be called in the old days one of the seven deadly sins, akkadia. Now, it's usually translated sloth, but that's a bad translation. Akkadia You know, it doesn't mean sloth. That's just like staying in the bathwater too long. Akedia means I don't care. You know, it's possible to walk by an old man sitting among the pigeons in the park and say, he's not my dad. It's possible to see a child cold and curled up in front of a store window and think, well, he's not my child. It's possible to look out at a recent widow wearing a gray shawl, looking at an even grayer world and think to yourself, well, she's not my mother. It's possible to hurl one final insult at the world. I don't care. He said, lady, do you realize what you did? You have charged me in our church with one of the seven deadly sins. And she said, so? He had heard the criticism before, not from her. He had heard it most forcefully from his father. His father didn't go to church. It was his mother who took them. But once in a while, the pastor would come by the house, try to talk to his father. It made his mother nervous because she knew that his father was capable of talking like a Philistine if he was, had a little pressure placed on him. And sometimes the pastor would bring by a guest evangelist and kind of point at him and say, now sick him, get him. Always his father's expressions were the same. He heard them 1,000 times. The church doesn't care anything about me. Another name, another pledge. What are you after? Another name, another pledge? What's the matter? A church budget? A little low? Another name, another pledge. You don't care about me. Another name, another pledge. Thank you, Reverend. He heard him say it 1,000 times while his mother wept in the kitchen. But one time he didn't say it. He was in the hospital in Memphis, the Veterans Hospital. He was down to 71 pounds, cancer of the throat. Too late, they said. Shouldn't have been smoking, they said. And they'd taken out everything, put a little metal tube in. He kind of put his finger up to his throat and make some sounds, but mostly he wrote. And when the son came to visit him and see his father in the hospital room, in every window there were flowers, a table by his bed, a stack this high of cards. Even the little thing they swing out over your bed with your meal on it had fresh flowers. All these cards, all these flowers from people and from groups in that church. And his father couldn't speak, so he got a Kleenex box and he wrote on it. And he wrote on the Kleenex box a line from Hamlet, in this harsh world, draw your breath to tell my story. He said, I will. Dad, what is it? And his father wrote, I was wrong. He was wrong. You know, the man got up to leave that woman's house that day, and he said, you're wrong. In my work, I travel all over the place, and everywhere I go, where they're hurting people, bereavement, people in pain, you see the footsteps of Christians who cared. Because every time they have come to offer a word of encouragement, a pie, a hug, or simply their presence. He said, people everywhere care. And she said, really? Yes. And she said, name some. Name some. She wants names. Could I give her yours? Could I give her yours? Will you pray with me? Oh Lord, sometimes we grow weary on the road to faith. But you never let go of us. And you keep going. And you bless us, Lord. And you send people into our lives to bless us and to walk with us. Help us to be those kind of people that encourage others when they're weary. Help us to be those kind of people who never let anyone go completely, and when we've missed them, we go and find them and tell them how much we care, how much you care. Because, Lord, we know you love us and you put your love in our hearts that we might share it with others. Lord, bless us and bless those who are struggling and hurting right now, those who've grown bitter, those who are just tired out. Revive us and fill us with your Spirit. Give us back some of your joy that we may serve you and worship you and follow in your footsteps and persevere as we run the race. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. And we all said together, amen. Bye.